The African American Legend series highlights the accomplishments of blacks in areas as varied as politics, sports, aviation, business, literature, and religion. We will explore how African Americans who have been previously excluded because of segregation, racism, and lack of opportunity have succeeded. I'm your host, Dr. Roscoe C. Brown, Jr., and with us today is Colonel Lee Buddy Archer, the only ace of the Tuskegee Airmen. Glad to have you with us today, Lee.
Thank you. Glad to be here, Roscoe.
Well, as a fellow Tuskegee Airman, I'd like to ask you, what motivated you to join the Tuskegee Airmen?
Well, truthfully, the big motivation was aviation. Mm-hmm. I wanted to be a pilot. I had been seeing airplanes, and if you know the Charlie Brown series, I was Snoopy Dog as a young man. Scarf, helmet, wanted to fly.
And making models.
Your eyes were in danger walking into my bedroom as a young boy with plywood models, all of them hand carved, hanging from the ceiling in different places. And a fan of World War I flying stories and aces. So I wanted to do it. And when I was about 18 or 19, I knew a war was coming despite our non-participation early on. I knew it was coming. I had come from a family of soldiers who had served in wars, a grandfather who served in the war, my father served in World War I, and I thought it was time to get in. I saw what Hitler was doing as a young college student, and I said, hey, we might as well get in this and get it over with. I knew about my father's record as infantryman, the Harlem 15th Health Fighters, 369th now, and their treatment. And he was never in love with the idea that I should do the same thing, be an infantryman or an artilleryman in segregation. And I thought about the Air Force and how it had been portrayed in stories. Also, a couple of years before, the Italians, an admiral named Balboa, had flown around the world with a squadron of seaplanes. And he came through New York, and I saw him, and I just fell in love with flying. That's what I wanted to do. So I just thought that not knowing about the segregation or actually the non-participation of African Americans in the Army Air Corps, I applied for it here in New York. And the story from there is similar to probably every one of the Tuskegee Airmen who became pilots. We applied, some of us passed, did very well, and then we waited. I applied with two young white kids who were friends of mine, and we all passed. A couple of months later, they got a call. I didn't get a call, so I went back down to the recruitment bureau and asked about it, and they were saying, well, they can't find the papers. They gave me a bunch of the stupid alibis they gave all of us. But finally, a second lieutenant down there who, I guess he decided, just to be honest, he just said, well, no, he said, we're never going to call you because our rules are that African Americans, colored, he used the term, can never be in the Army Air Corps.
Now, why don't you talk about the 1925 study, which helped to set that pace?
Well, even the lieutenant didn't know about that. But the 1925 staff study was written when the Army Air Corps was a part of the Army. In fact, it had just separated from the Signal Corps. And this study made a couple of decisions that about colored soldiers. They also had a part of the study that also prevented Orientals, which is now, I guess, politically correct to call Asiatics, could be nothing but in the Marine Corps and the Navy as servants, so-called. It also decided that in the Army Air Corps, there should never be any African Americans. And they gave four reasons why. One, just not as bright as other people. Two, they generally lack courage and leadership. Three, they can never learn to operate equipment, complicated equipment. And four, this was their piece de resistance, that they lack coordination. This was about the silliest thing I'd ever heard in my life. Then they had a fifth reason that was stated in another study that said that colored people should never be in the Army Air Corps because they become officers. Mm-hmm. And no white man should ever have to take an order from a man of color. And that was it. You will remember that in those days, the system in the military was really based on segregation and separation as it is in the South. I mean, that was it. The military was ruled by a bunch of Southerners. The officers of it were predominantly Southerners. They had lost the Civil War and had regrouped in the military. And I can talk about that regrouping later about something else that I think they've regrouped in. But that was it. And they imposed their system on it. And the military accepted it. I was in the service. And that was a sort of a joke. I think I made such a pest of myself down at the recruiting office that I got a letter from the government. And it was not one of those Dear Lee statements that draftees got, you know, from the president. Mine said that we welcome you to the United States Army. You have volunteered for it and accepted. Please report to Camp Upton, such and such a date.
Well, before you get to that point, why don't you talk a little about the change in the political climate that began to make it a challenge to refute that 1925 study, the activities that brought about the creation of the Tuskegee Airmen?
Well, that came after I was in the service, okay. Actually. Mm-hmm. This one in 1941, just before Pearl Harbor, they accepted me into the Army, except the acceptance was a threatening thing. The letter stated that I had applied to the United States Army to be inducted with a hope of being in the Army Air Corps. Since I could never be in the Army Air Corps because of my color, that was sorry, but we are accepting your volunteering for the Army. And in fact, there was a little last paragraph in the letter, and it said, you report to Camp Upton on such and such a date and time. This is all before Pearl Harbor. And it said, in the event that you are unable to find out where Camp Upton is, we'll send someone to escort you. Now, if that wasn't a threat, I don't know. So I found Camp Upton, and they sent me away to Georgia, to a place called Camp Wheeler, outside of a town called Macon. And if you follow my career in the military or my airplanes and all, you'll see that name come up frequently. I ended up in the infantry. The thing I remember about that, Dr. Brown, was that they put me on a train in Pennsylvania Station, along with Sam Anderson, a few other African-American fellas, and a bunch of white fellas who were leaving Camp Upton. And when we got to Washington, D.C., they pulled all of the people of color off the airplane, off the train, moved us to the first car behind the engine, and the engines were coal in those days, coal that you burn, and put other people on the train there. I remember distinctly thinking that this has got to be the worst thing that's ever happened to me. In my capital of my country, that I'm going to fight for. They take me off a train where I'm sitting with everybody and put me in a car alone with all the other people of color. It was the first time something that happened in my life. And I was pretty bitter about it. I ended up in Macon, Georgia, in Camp Wheeler. I became a telegrapher and graduated at a school of field network communication. This is how they keep control in those days of military units scattered all over. And you set up networks for them and things, and then did radio code. I was rather good at it, I must say. I got promoted every time they looked at me. And then the Air Force decided, the Army Air Corps decided, that they would do what we call the Tuskegee experiment. Now, back to where you asked me to start. Mrs. Roosevelt was a part of the Rosenwald Foundation, and she is at Tuskegee. Rosenwald people were very supportive of black educational activities. And she was down there, and she met a fellow by the name of Alfred Anderson, known to us as Chief Anderson. He was one of the first pilots to have an instructor's license, and he was African-American. And he was flying at Tuskegee under one of the special programs they had to teach pilots to fly in the event they would need pilots in the war. They had given it to 100 and some odd white colleges, and then by special regulation, because the predominantly black colleges couldn't be a part of it, came under some new regulation that gave them to them for 4 or 5 black colleges. Mrs. Roosevelt convinced her husband, Franklin D., who was running then for a third term, it was a political move, that he could capture the black vote.
But there was also the NAACP and the threat of legal action that helped to catalyze this movement. So you're right. A. Philip Randolph threatened a march on Washington, 100,000 black folks. So that the tenor of the time was, it's ready to go. So
confrontational,
they picked the Tuskegee Airmen as an experiment. And
that's
Lee
correct.
Archer was one of the first people in that experiment.
Incidentally, you mentioned the confrontation part. A fellow by the name of Yancey Williams out of Washington, D.C. had sued the government about this case. And the NAACP had set up a second man by the name of Span Watson that when the first case was over, then Watson would sue. And so these things. But I think that Mr. Roosevelt agreed for one thing, trying to capture what was called the colored vote in those days. And he decided on the experiment. The government made then 2 mistakes as far as I'm concerned. Number one was that they went back to all the people who had been giving them trouble trying to volunteer for the Army Air Corps and asked them, do you still want to try this? And of course they all said yes. I think they picked people with the best education, the best background, enough brains to have passed the test, some without a college degree and all. And the second, they decided that instead of putting us into the organization, one here, one there, one where they could have picked us off little by little, they decided to build this special little air base down near Tuskegee Institute in those days to train us. And we would do all 4 of our trainings in that one area rather than go to primary here, basic at another base, advance another one in fighter or bomber training somewhere else. That built in us a lot of cohesion and esprit de corps and things like that that was stronger than any unit I could ever think of. And I stayed in the service almost 30 years.
Now, the reputation of the Tuskegee Airmen, other than breaking the barriers that said blacks couldn't fly, really stemmed from our success in combat.
Oh, yes.
The Tuskegee Airmen, the 4 squadrons, the 99th Pursuit Squadron, 99th Fighter Squadron, the 100th
Pursuit,
Fighter Squadron.
You were right at first.
So. One of the things that we know is that the Air Force went, Air Corps went through changes. It was the Air Corps, then the Air Force. Now today it's the United States Air Force as a separate department. But the 332nd Fighter Group had the responsibility of escorting bombers over Germany as they were using the strategic bombing, and our responsibility, I was in the 100th Fighter Squadron, you in the 302,
remember it well.
Was to protect the bombers. And the record that we achieved of never losing a bomber to enemy fighters is a record that was not achieved by any fighter group in history. Mm-hmm. With our silver Mustangs with flaming red tails, we became known as the Red Tail Angels. Now in doing this, we did have some combat. Flying is great, but also when you're in war, your job is to protect the bombers and to shoot anybody down. Mm-hmm. I know that you became the Tuskegee Airmen's first ace, five planes shot down. And we have here some footage of combat. Footage of planes being shot down, footage of what we did as Tuskegee Airmen. So let's take a moment to look at that.
The morning fighter patrol. They're flying over Italy, and there are others like them flying over Burma, over the coast of Holland, over China, and over Germany, in search of the enemy. Enemy planes. The odds are bad this morning, nearly 3-1. The routine morning patrol goes on. They close the range. 3,500 feet. 3,000. 2,500. 2,000. The odds are still 3-1. But it's three Nazis spinning down in blood and flame to every one of ours. They fight the enemy on his own soil.
Okay, Lee, you shot down planes, I shot down planes. Tell me, how does it really feel to have shot down a plane?
Well, truthfully, I have no feeling about it whatsoever. It's just to be a job. In fact, early on, I kind of considered this kind of a gentleman warrior sort of thing.
Like in World War I, where a guy would bail out and you wiggle your wings.
Well, and I did that on the first one. first victory I received, Pruitt and I shot the airplane down, the pilot bailed out, and I zoomed over toward him, hanging in his parachute, and Pruitt says, "Hey, buddy." And I guess he thought I was going to
shoot it down,
but I didn't. I circled him because there were airplanes all over the place. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to make sure no one did touch mm-hmm. him. And so Pruitt and I circled him till he landed and was picked up. That's the kind of thing we believed in. We didn't want anybody shooting up people on the ground unless they were enemies and all.
But he was an enemy. One of the ironies of that.
The idea wasn't to kill him. It was to destroy his ability to fight.
But then after he bailed out, the next hour, he was in another plane going to shoot us down.
That's true, but that was never a point. And in fact, you almost slipped early on when you called it to, the Pursuit Squadron. We made a change. Early on, the squadrons and the group as a whole were doing tactical work, dive bombing, strafing, things like that. And in fact, their record there was outstanding. And then as we started losing bombers to enemy fighters, they established the 15th Air Force, Strategic Air Force, as they call it. And they then decided that the 332nd Fighter Group would protect the bombers. Now, you mentioned our record in that case. How did that record come about? It was very simple. Up to then, we had been pursuit squadrons. Based on the American and most military policies, that what you did was get into a fight, one-on-one, two-on-two, or whatever it was, and the enemy wanted to get out of it, he would run, and you would follow him. You would pursue him, follow after him, pursue. That was the policy. Every other group in the Air Force followed that. Now, this was not a good thing for bomber pilots. Enemy fighters would hit the bombers on a long mission, and then they'd break and run. And the American pilots would go chasing them in pursuit. The idea, you follow them home if you have to. Fine. But while they were following them home, the second group of German fighters would come and attack the bombers with no protection, and the bombers would go to hell. We had a commander, as you remember, Benjamin O. Davis, Jr., who had a longer view than anyone else did. And he knew that if we lost bombers, in any case, because we were not there or because we were derelict in some respect, that there are people in the States who would have had us brought home in a minute. Our reputation would have been shot. So his rule was never chase a bomber. Stay.
Never chase a fighter.
Chase a fighter. Stay with the bombers no matter what. And in fact, that's why there's only one fighter ace out of the Tuskegee Airmen. There must be 8 or 9 guys with 3 or 4, you know yourself, that you could have had a lot more victories if you could have gone chasing them. Okay. So we gave that up. But we gave it up and received a great reputation. In fact, the general's airplane now was being called by request because the bomber groups would ask, why can't we have the Red Tails protect us? They then also changed the name from pursuit squadrons to fighter squadrons. Hot pursuit was no longer the way we'd fought combat. We fought combat by fighting, and so you didn't have to go chase it. My biggest regret is that so many of the Tuskegee Airmen, many of you didn't get the kind of credit you could have gotten if you'd been permitted to fight the war the way white fighter pilots did.
On the other hand, the fact that we accomplished this record of never losing a bomber made us the most famous fighter group in World War II.
Not the most famous, the most productive, and one of the best. Incidentally, that's another case of what we call, they give you lemons, make lemonade. Mm-hmm. It acted to our benefit. That's another mistake that they made, as if going and get the old guys who had created problems for them and ask them, do they want to be in? And the same thing here.
Now, some 50 plus years afterwards, you and I and the other Tuskegee Airmen are recognized all over the country because of our dedication, our skill, I being the first one to shoot on a jet plane and you being a fighter ace. And people ask us all the time, why did we do it? So I'm going to ask you the question. I know why I did it. I think I know why you did it. But will you tell our audience why you risked your life in the most dangerous branch of the service to fight for your country?
The last two words, it's my country. I don't care what anyone else says about it or how they feel about it. It's my country also. And most of us of color have been here longer than everyone else. I recently had an argument with a guy who said, well, you know, we came here. And I said, no, we didn't come here. I was here when you came. And at Ellis Island, where recently you were honored as it. So this is my country. I don't care what they want. I wanted to protect it. And it wasn't to prove anything at all. Two things. One, I could fly and fight. And if that would have required that I pay a little dues by having combat, that was it. Two, this is my country. I have a duty and a responsibility to it. whether they like it or not, because sooner or later, whether they like it or not, it's going to have to change. All right? So it's changing every day. The segregation in the military that was so endemic and so strict on it changed rapidly in 1947 and 48. 47, they made the Air Force a separate organization. But 48, Harry Truman issues Executive Order 9981, which just made a ridiculous thing of the 1925 stat study. 28th of July, 1948, we're integrating the services, and he named the reasons for why, one of which was our record at the Tuskegee Airmen. And it's going to happen. At the time, I was at UCLA in the military as a student, and my sisters here in New York used to send me little clippings in the paper where everybody prophesied that the integration of the service would destroy the service and that thousands of people would do. So I wrote a study as a student in the school and a returned war veteran to find out how many quit. I could not find any. And the reason was that the military, when they make a rule to change things, if they enforce it, they do enforce it. It makes it difficult to dodge the results of not abiding by the law. And so the Air Force changed immediately. I was away in school. A full colonel by the name of Ed Gleed came to California to tell me, buddy, you're never going back to a segregated unit. And I wasn't. The next time I was in a unit after I graduated, I was in a fighter squadron to get ready to go to Guam to go to Korea. And I was the only man of color in it.
And of course, today you're the only man of color in the Gathering Eagles, the Fighter Aces organization. Those of us in Tuskegee Airmen are obviously very proud that you're there, and you have an opportunity to interact with all the great fighter aces of the world. How does that feel?
I hate to gloat like this, but it was really great. This is part of the thing. Command pilot, highest ranking that you can have in the aviation. And the fact that I was doing seminars at the Command and General Staff College where the young men and women, many of them of color, many of foreign nations, honoring what they call the first in flight. The idea is that this recognized people from all over the world, from different countries, who had been the first to do something.
And Lee Archer is first in flight among the Tuskegee Airmen. We've been talking with Lieutenant Colonel Buddy Archer, Tuskegee Airman ace, on today's African American Legend.
Thank you, Dr.
Glad to
Brown.
Have you with us, buddy.
Good to see you again.
They're flying over Italy, and there are others like them flying over Burma, over the coast of Holland, over China, and over Germany, in search of the enemy. Enemy planes. The odds are bad this morning, nearly 3-1. The routine morning patrol goes on. They close the range, 3,500 feet, 3,000, 2,500, 2,000. The odds are still 3-1. But it's three Nazis spinning down in blood and flame to every one of ours.